Computers are everywhere, as laptops, mobile phones, and even household devices. In fact, you're looking at one right now, but do you know what a computer actually is? In 1936, Alan Turing described a theoretical model of a computing machine. This so-called Turing machine contains two things. One, there is an endless tape of data, and two, a table of rules. A reading and writing head moves along the tape, reads the data, and, according to the rules, changes its value. This Turing machine is the first step of our answer. A computer is a machine that modifies data according to rules. But as I mentioned before, the Turing machine is a purely theoretical model. The question now is, how can we build a physical machine that can actually do this? Our computers are based on electricity, or electronic circuits that can be either on or off. Now, how can we translate data and rules into these two states? To make this work, we're going to use a simple yet powerful trick. We refer to our two states, on and off, as digits, 1 and 0. Then we can express almost any type of data as numbers. Let me show you how it's done. Because we have 10 fingers, we count with 10 digits, from 0 to 9. When a number is bigger than 9, we use multiple positions. The first position holds multiples of 1, the next multiples of 10, then 10 times 10, then 10 times 10 times 10, and so on. Let's say we want to write the number 14. In this decimal system, we can write it as 10 plus 4. It is called decimal because it is based on the number 10. Now, how would we count if, instead of 10 fingers, we only had 2? We can do something similar, again using multiple positions. Only this time, each position represents a potency of 2. We start with 1, the next position is 2, then 2 times 2, then 2 times 2 times 2, and so on. The number 14 is 8 plus 4 plus 2. So in that system, it looks like this: 1, 1, 1, 0. With this binary system, we can express any number using only two digits, 1 and 0, or two states of an electronic circuit, on and off. So as soon as we can translate any type of data into such binary numbers, it can be used by an electronic computer. Like, for example, with text, we can simply assign every letter to a number. For instance, we could pick the number 97 and establish that it stands for the lowercase a. The next number, 98, could stand for b, and so on. Of course, all of us would have to agree to such a translation. The Unicode standard is such an agreement. If we want to represent the word hello in numbers, we simply have to look up every letter in this Unicode table. And of course, these numbers can also be written using our binary system. To express images as numbers, we can divide them into small picture elements, so-called pixels. In a simple grayscale picture, each pixel is represented by a number between 0 and 255, with 0 standing for black and 255 for white. The values in between represent varying shades of gray. An image can thus be written as a list of pixel values. Of course, our image here looks a bit rough. If we want an image with a better quality, we have to use a finer grid, which results in more pixels and thus more numbers. This is why images in a high resolution are usually quite large in file size. What about sound? Sound is basically a swinging movement of air, which we can represent as a sound curve. To translate this curve into numbers, we proceed in a similar fashion as we did before with the images. We apply a grid. The x-axis is subdivided into little time steps. At each of these time steps, we measure the current position on the vertical axis. This number is called a sample. A sound file is basically a list of such samples. And just like with the images, if we want to increase the quality of the sound, we simply have to use a finer grid. I just showed you a couple of ways of how to translate information into numbers. Of course, there are many more, but the idea is always the same. We find a way to represent data as binary numbers, which can ultimately be translated into states of electricity on and off. We call this translation into numbers digitization. Now that we know what digital data is, the next question is, how can we tell a computer what to do with it? Let's look at an example. Let's say I want a computer to regulate the temperature of this room. In our natural language, I could say something like, I want a comfortable room temperature. The problem with this sentence is that it is quite vague. It doesn't tell us how high a comfortable temperature actually is or what to do about it exactly. When we talk to other people, such imprecise sentences usually work. People can fill in the blanks, but a machine needs precise instructions. So, how about we try something like this instead? If the temperature is below 20 degrees Celsius and the heating is off, then turn on the heating. Okay, this sentence is quite a mouthful, but it is a precise instruction. Why? It uses numbers and logic. Logical statements are sentences that can be either true or false. In our example, the temperature is below 20 degrees Celsius and the heating is off are both statements that can be true or false. Only when both parts are true, the heating is turned on. This is expressed by the word AND. That little word AND is a logical operator. There are also other logical operators like OR and NOT. They are the fundamental building blocks of logical statements. Now, the exciting part is these operators can be built as electronic circuits. For example, this circuit represents our operator AND. Electricity can only flow if both switches are on. That one stands for OR. Electricity can flow as soon as at least one of them is on. What this means is that once we can say what we want in a precise logical manner, electronic circuits can do it. So, this is how you talk to a computer. The first step is to use logical instructions. As we've seen before, such logical sentences can be quite cumbersome and long. This is why people invented more practical languages that are shorter and better suited to write instructions. These languages are called programming languages. They might look a bit strange at first, but once you get used to them, they are a great and efficient way to write precise, logical instructions. After we've written our instructions in such a programming language, they are automatically translated into machine code. And this machine code controls the electronics of our computer. We call the first three steps of this process programming, because we can combine many instructions into a program. You might at first think that learning the programming language is the hardest part, but in fact, it is the step before that is most difficult, to use a logical language. Our natural language is much richer and expressive than pure logic. This is why we find it hard to squeeze what we want to say into logical instructions. So, when we say that we find computers difficult, it is quite often not the machine that is the problem, but rather the fact that we're not used to such rigorous logic. As I mentioned before, we can write programs made of many instructions. What's so special about these programs is that the computer can decide to jump between the instructions depending on the situation. This is also the reason why you never play the same computer game twice. Well, at least not in the exact same way. Depending on what buttons you press and when, the order of the instruction changes. A computer program is a dynamic system. Okay, finally we know what a computer is. A digital electronic computer is a machine that modifies data expressed in numbers according to rules based on values of true and false. But what is it that makes these machines so special, so powerful, so wonderful, and so terrifying? Well, basically, we built a machine that can take information from the outside world and do something similar to rational thinking. We took something that is characteristic for us humans and let machines do that. And now we see these machines doing all sorts of incredible things. This raises many fascinating questions that cut right to the bone of human existence, like, are these machines like us? Or are they even better? Can they replace us? What is it that we can do but they can't? For instance, can they be creative? Hit the subscribe button below so we can discuss some of these questions together in the next videos.